professor here in the physics department, for those of you who don't know me or visiting us. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome you here and to introduce tonight's speaker. But before I do that, I wanted to say a few words about this event at the expense of maybe boring some of the members of the Institute who've already heard this or are familiar with the local ones, most familiar with this. This is mostly for the benefit of the general audience. So this event is part of this series of lectures, part of a so-called Boulder Summer School for Condensed Matter and Materials Physics that we hold here every year in July for 4 weeks. So the school is kind of an advanced study institute where we invite 65 best and brightest students from all over the world. Maybe best and brightest could raise their hand and wave, so you can see dominating the audience. So best and brightest come here for 4 weeks to learn some of the most advanced topics in theoretical physics from some of the world experts in the area of the school. And every year, different topics of the school are being explored. And this is the 16th annual school, so we've done lectures or schools ranging from superconductivity to biophysics to polymers and such. Mostly, always focus on some kind of material science, whether soft materials or hard materials, electronic or biological. The school is very generously supported by National Science Foundation, so we're grateful to them and grateful to you, the members of the public, for your support of sciences. And this is sort of, this lecture is a small token of our appreciation and to give something back and your tax dollars at work. As I said, every year school is in a different subject, and the lectures are very different depending on what the subject is. And this year's school is on so-called soft condensed matter physics, maybe a less well-known cousin of maybe a better-known solid-state physics, traditional solid-state physics that deals with hard materials like semiconductors, insulators, hard materials. Soft materials are, as the name implies, soft, squishy, and they're really actually quite common. Milk, your tissue, various biological materials, colloids, polymers, liquid crystal materials in the display of your laptop or your iPhones. Those are all soft materials, and we're interested in the behavior of those soft materials. And in particular, this school is not just soft materials, but with a somewhat of a focus on non-equilibrium soft materials and also frustration soft materials. So that's the topic. With that, let me introduce tonight's speaker. He is Professor David Nelson, a world expert in soft condensed matter physics and statistical mechanics in general. He's the author of numerous papers, seminal papers, and is well known. It really doesn't need any introduction to condensed matter physics, and certainly not in soft matter physics. David Nelson received his PhD from Cornell, and actually all his degrees from Cornell, after which he, in late 70s, he moved to Harvard, where he is now a chaired professor of physics, applied physics, and biology. He's got diverse interests, but they're all centered around this kind of a soft matter and statistical physics, and kind of interplay of geometry and fluctuations. Besides being distinguished scientist, extremely distinguished scientist, he's also well known for ability to give very clear pedagogical exposition to of this type to general audience, exposition of physics, and really especially very challenging and kind of sophisticated concepts presented in a very simple and beautiful and physical way, as undoubtedly he will demonstrate tonight. No pressure, David. he's been duly recognized by many, many awards, but most notably, he's a fellow of National Academy of Science. He's won the Bardeen Prize, Buckley Prize, the highest prize in the American Physical Society, and he's also a genius, as acknowledged by the MacArthur Prize, the MacArthur Foundation. So he's really a certified.
That was succeeded and embarrassing.
Well, you will see now why. So on a personal note, I had the honor and benefit of being one of David's students in the late 90s. So I owe him a lot for really teaching me physics, introducing me to physics, and really teaching me how to think deeply, carefully and honestly about theoretical physics. And so to that, I'm really indebted to him. And so with that, without further ado, please join me in welcoming David Nelson.
Well, thank you, Leo, and thank you all for coming. I'm going to talk about crumpling and wrinkling of various kinds of polymers and membranes. And some of them will be biological, some of them will be the components of hefty bags and sandwich bags. So there'll be a broad spectrum of materials that I'll talk about here. And maybe I can just have a show of hands in this audience. How many of you have seen the classic 20th century film starring Dustin Hoffman called The Graduate? Fair number. Anybody remember the advice that Dustin was given at the party after he graduated?
Plastics.
So that's what I'm going to start talking about. There's been a number of revolutions in the 20th century. Of course, there's the semiconductor revolution and the transistor. But another revolution, which is also quite important, is the ability to do chemical synthesis of polymers. And these synthetic polymers were developed partly because of the impetus of World War II and exotic materials, perhaps from the Malay Archipelago or the Philippines or whatever, were cut off. And so chemists went to work making their own linear polymer chains, which surround all of us. I'll give you some examples as we go along. For example, if you take this humble chemical molecule, ethylene, some carbons and some hydrogens with a double bond, and you take N of them, N is a very large number for most of this lecture. It could be 10,000, could be a million, whatever, 100,000 perhaps. Shine some ultraviolet light on the solution of these ethylenes. You break open these bonds, and then the thing rearranges to form a long linear chain with a huge molecular weight, gigantic molecular weights, which themselves would be 100,000 or close to a million. This would be called polyethylene, and it's simply this motif, which in this case is carbon and two hydrogens, repeated almost ad infinitum. And there are all sorts of variations on a theme. So hefty bags that you might put your garbage in are polyethylene, and they are a tangled array, a kind of tangled mess. It's sort of semi-solid but very flexible mess in these long linear polymer chains like polyethylene here. Another example is polystyrene. So if you might have had coffee at Dunkin' Donuts with a polystyrene cup, which has excellent insulating properties. And again, it's this motif, which has this kind of aromatic benzene ring or something like it, attached to one element, repeated again 100,000, 10,000 times. What we'll see is that as N gets big, the details, at least for some of the properties, drop out. And all sorts of interesting chemistry can be in here, which can play an important role. But many of the microscopic details will be less important, and there's a kind of universality that arises. Another one of these polymer melts, I mean, they're melted when you manufacture them, but then they solidify to form a hefty bag or something else with a shear modulus. So it resists shear. And another example, which is quite a hard material, is polymethyl methacrylate. It's quite likely that these eyeglasses are made out of some relative of polymethyl methacrylate. And by tuning these groups, you can get whatever bending strength or index of refraction of light. You get a lot of possibilities and tune things. And so aircraft windows, lucite, transparent sheets, Perspex is used in these eyeglasses. So these plastics or these polymers really are all around us. There's another example which is a little less familiar, and that's polyethylene oxide, affectionately known as polyox. And a few parts per million by weight of this long polymer chain substance injected in water reduces the turbulent drag coefficient by order of magnitude, or maybe 50%, whatever. That turns out to be very useful in principle, because, for example, if you can reduce the friction of water that's squirting out of a fireman's hose, here he's attempting to save this damsel in distress, a picture from Pierre Gilles de Gennes, it will squirt up four stories or five stories instead of one or two, just with the addition of an almost negligible weight fraction of this polymer. It has a kind of magical way of damping out the turbulence. And a relative of polyoxide, the same idea, is one of the things that made the Alaska oil pipeline viable. So you're pumping the oil down from down to the lower 48, and any friction in that pipe is your enemy. And there's some additive that really has changed the equation for getting oil relatively cheaply down, say, from OIC. So that's another example. This is not a polymer melt. This is a dilute polymer solution. And that's actually what I'm going to focus on, because dilute long-chain polymers also play a central role in biology. We started synthesizing polymers, that is, humanity started doing them, say, in the 1940s, approximately. But for billions of years, nature has been making its own polymers in living things. And what I show here is a rendition of the what's called the central dogma of molecular biology. And of course, this new era was heralded by the discovery of the structure of DNA. Here are Watson and Crick looking at the structure of this famous molecule, figured out using Rosalind Franklin's data, I might add. And then that's a itself, as we'll see, a long chain polymer, but DNA isn't the only one in biology. There are other ones called RNA and proteins, and they all enter this central dogma of molecular biology. The golden age of molecular biology is probably still going on, but it began in the 1960s and 70s and so forth, when it was realized what this DNA, this biological linear polymer chain, was actually doing. The cartoon over here shows that DNA can replicate itself, so it can make more of itself, an essential feature of living matter. And there are beautiful protein machines that can sort of split apart the DNA double helix. So if I take this electrical cord as a kind of simple proxy, for DNA, it's not really DNA, it's just something I cut up. And it has two strands, right? So sometimes these are, one's called Watson and one's called Crick. And there's complementary base pairing. And you can imagine that to replicate the DNA, you're going to have to pull these apart. So I can do it for this electrical cord with my hands. But there's actually an exquisite molecular machine, again, probably the product of a billion or 3 billion years of evolution, called helicase, that splits this down the middle, preparing a cell for cell division. Every time a cell divides, this has to happen. You split this long polymer in two. Another polymer arises naturally when DNA, which often resides in the nucleus of animal cells, is transcribed. Transcription just means the analog of copying someone's lecture notes verbatim. If you missed a class, for example, and a close relative of DNA called RNA, or messenger RNA, is created. So that's the second long-chain polymer. And then that creation process is mediated by another machine, which creates this messenger transcript. So coming out of this is the double-stranded DNA, the helix, and coming out of it is this, this messenger, which, when it leaves the nucleus, is acted upon by yet another machine called a ribosome, and those ribosomes themselves make a third kind of linear polymer chain. And what you're seeing, not so distinctly in this electron micrograph, is a long chain of messenger RNA. These balls are the ribosomes, and then coming out of these factories, these ribosome factories, are a chain of amino acids. So now the building blocks are the 20 different kinds of amino acids that make up most of life, and some of them are longer on one side than the other because it's a progressive synthesis of a protein that is essentially translated, not transcribed, but translated via a three-letter genetic code into a protein. And then these proteins fold up in wonderful ways. Some of them are fairly pedestrian-like packing materials, but some of them actually fold up to make these machines. So this central dogma ultimately terminates in the simplest model in terms of proteins, which then go back to act on the central dogma. So there's a feedback loop that is an essential ingredient of life involving linear polymers and these molecular machines. Now, we live in an interesting time because not only do we have to have some understanding of these animal cells that evolved in the central dogma, similar things go on in bacteria, there's a bacterium called E. coli. There are more copies of that bacterium in every adult's intestines than there are humans on the face of the earth. And not only do bacteria and animals have a kind of hard drive code with DNA that tells them sort of what to do, there are also viruses. So if you get the flu, you are probably having your animal cells infected by one of these guys or one of its relatives. This one happens to infect bacteria. If you've ever been hiking in, the deep woods of Maine, you often will get attacked not only by horse flies, but by mosquitoes. And if you are a bacterium, that's sort of what happens to you as all these viruses glom on and attempt to inject, as if they were hypodermic needles, the DNA into this hapless bacterium. It's about 2 microns long. Micron is just short for micrometer, 1 millionth of a meter. And then their DNA, which is initially packed in this head, this very small viral head, starts taking over. And it's very much like a computer virus. In fact, that's where the name comes from. It started in biology first. And this packing of what can be very large amount of DNA, this is an exploded virus, a virus that I think may have been osmotically shocked. And the effect of opening it up, breaking it open, is to cause a kind of explosion of the DNA coil out into the outside world. And it sort of looks like it had to have been packed very, very tightly. And so in fact, if you just look at numbers, about 50 of these micrometers of DNA gets packed into every viral head. The viral head itself is only a tenth of a micron across, so it's packed into something which is 500 times smaller than it is long. So if I take this shoelace as a kind of proxy for the DNA, well, it's sort of like storing mountaineer's rope. So who knows what's really going on in there? People are still arguing about it, but I could coil this up in some very tightly packed way. And one important question is, what is the right packing strategy? What would this amount of DNA, this 50 microns, actually like to be? What is its typical size? And how much does it compress as you squeeze it into a volume that's 500 times longer than the diameter of the little space that you're trying to squeeze? So that's the kind of polymer physics question, or polymer biology, or chemistry, whatever you'd like to understand. And one of the really exciting developments in the last 15 or 20 years is that experimental scientists, sometimes with physics, sometimes with a foot in biology, have been able to take these ingredients of the central dogma and sort of literally pull and tug at them one molecule at a time to try to see what's going on. And it really is as if instead of using a helicase, you can reach in and pull on the two strands and sort of unzip the DNA zipper and try to figure out what's going on as you pull these things apart. This is an experiment by my colleague Mara Prentice. And what she did was to hang along a thin glass capillary tube a lot of connectors, a lot of connecting points for double-stranded DNA, which split, much like this electrical cord, and it's ready to be unzipped because there's one of the two strands, say Watson or Crick, is attached to a little polystyrene bead, a couple microns across, and then using a remarkable tool called a laser tweezer, you can grab on this thing, or you can do it magnetically. If you have magnetic beads, just use a refrigerator magnet. And that refrigerator magnet can unzip the DNA. And so what's shown here is it's an actual experiment. There's a whole bunch of these sort of arrayed along a flagpole. There's an applied force, and then they sort of unzip progressively. And some of them remain sort of folded up temporarily. You sit around and wait, this non-equilibrium process unzips. This one is almost completely unzipped. This is halfway. And you can actually track what a helicase has to deal with as it pulls apart this DNA double helix. And so this is sort of what's going on in cartoon form. But it's not a featureless ladder that's being unraveled here. It's the genetic code. And so some of you may know that we have these different kinds of nucleotide pairs. There's adenine and thymine, so that's a pair of nucleotides denoted by A and T. They have sort of two hydrogen bonds that are gluing them together, and then three hydrogen bonds will glue together G and T. So the stronger bonding between some letters, some pairs of the genetic code than others. And what you're seeing here is a function of time in seconds. So 1,000 seconds is about 15 minutes. So you're watching the unraveling of this thing, which behaves like a jerky zipper. So it's a zipper that goes partway, and then it gets stuck. Where does it get stuck? It seems to get stuck on these GT base pairs. So there's a long run of strong bonds. It gets stuck. And by looking at these, this pattern of plateaus and jumps, you can actually learn something about the genetic code. You can actually read the genetic code, at least partially. There are other ways to do it, but this is, I think, a beautiful way of sort of pulling on these polymers and trying to figure out some information about biology and also the physics of what happens when we unzip things that are just one polymer strand thick. And so, you can get energy barriers, jumps, and kind of two-level systems going on here. And that's one aspect of this revolution in sort of single-molecule biophysics. But what I want to focus on, kind of motivate a discussion of layered polymer chains, is this experiment here. So I think this one is from Carlos Bustamante's group. He's a professor at Berkeley. And so what did he do? Well, he let double-stranded DNA be converted into from a single-stranded DNA template. And this little thing here is an enzyme. It's a DNA polymerase. It can also go backwards, but let's imagine it's taking nucleotides out here and doing complementary base pairing so that this enzyme will move from left to right, thus converting single-stranded DNA into double-stranded DNA. Now you can't see these things with the naked eye, but you can infer their existence, again, by tethering one of these large, relatively large, micron-sized beads. And this is a laser tweezer. It's just the focal point of a laser, and it was discovered by Steve Chu and others. Steve Chu used to be our Secretary of Energy, Nobel laureate, part for this discovery, you can take these tweezers and sort of pull on this thing and look as a function of force what's going on. And one of the messages is I'm trying to convince you that this thing is It's basically like two springs in series. So let's imagine that this white shoelace is the single-stranded DNA, this is double-stranded DNA. I'm going to try to convince you that just due to counting on your sort of on your fingers, you can convince yourself that this brown half, the double-stranded half, is going to act like a spring. It doesn't look like a spring, it's pretty flaccid, but I want to convince you that that's not true on this molecular scale. This is another spring, which in this experiment is sort of in series with the first spring. And if you look at what happens, you can put on a force, an exquisitely calibrated force with these laser tweezers, and the standard unit of force that we often teach in introductory physics is called a newton. And these forces are measured in piconewtons, which is like 10 to the minus 15 newtons. The newton is like the weight of a brick, and we're down here many, many orders of magnitude smaller with exquisite precision, pulling with this laser tweezer. And then by looking at how it responds, and this is the fractional extension of the polymer. Double-stranded DNA, when it jerks taut, is sort of right about here at 1 in these units. So that's sort of what happens when this brown shoelace gets fully extended. And then this is the single-stranded DNA coming out here. And these are basically measuring the spring constant of the single-stranded and the double-stranded, which are these two things in series. Although it's not going to be so important for this particular talk, the beauty of this experiment for biologists is that you can actually monitor the progress of this enzyme, which you can't see either. Can't see the DNA, can't see the enzyme, but if you just take a simple model of two springs in series, you can watch the conversion of double-stranded to single-stranded DNA in this one simple experiment acting on one single DNA. And the question I want to spend a little time on, because I think it gives some intuition for some phenomena that's very important in soft matter physics, namely entropy, is why is the single-stranded DNA stiffer than the double-stranded? So what do I mean by that? Well, if we try to fit a slope, let's say, here, so this is the single-stranded DNA. This little slope here is this constant K. So this is, we call this Hooke's law. Force is proportional to the extension. If I look at the single-stranded DNA, it's fairly stiff. And if I look at the double-stranded DNA, there is a slope there, but it's so nearly zero, I can hardly see it with this level of magnification. And you might have expected the opposite. A big fat spring, maybe like the double-stranded DNA, that should be stronger than the single-stranded. And here, the reverse is true. And the question is why? And I'll telegraph, for those of you that get so bored you want to sneak out, the answer. The answer to this puzzle is that this spring constant is almost entirely due to entropy. And how many of you have run into the word entropy in a course or in your lives? I hope to give you some idea of it, but this is one real practical application of it. And suffice it to say that whenever you have a result in science that has temperature in it, this KB is just a constant due to Boltzmann. We'll talk about that a little later. Entropy is involved. And a crucial thing, which is misspelled here, is called the persistence length. And we'll see that that persistence length is really the important feature here. And there's a springiness to these linear polymer chains. It has nothing to do with, really nothing to do with energetics, but everything to do with entropy. So we'll get back to this, but this contour length is the total number of nucleotides. And this persistence length, as we'll get to as well, is a kind of a length scale over which the DNA can bend. So that's where we're headed. And this is going to be important. If I want to compactify DNA and fit it back in this viral head, I'm going to have to bend it. And we'd like to know what its natural size is when we take into account entropy and other things. It is rather springy, as we'll see, even though there aren't that many strong interactions between double-stranded DNA. Viral genomes typically contain 50,000 base pairs. We already mentioned that you're squeezing a 50 micron length into a tiny, tiny volume, something 500 times smaller. That's also a challenge to some extent, even in bacteria. These are these rod-shaped bacteria that live in our guts. Most of the time they're benign, but some of them can cause some nasty infections. So they too have DNA. They don't have 50,000 base pairs, they have maybe 5 million. They're being impactified in a relatively small volume. These things are about 2 microns long, 1 micron across. And so the questions that are related is, you know, what happens? How much do we have to compress the DNA to squeeze, say, the millimeter and a half length of DNA for a bacterium into a much, much smaller size? These bacteria are about 3 micron cubed. And what about compactifying a virus? And although I won't be able to derive it, I'll tell you in advance that when you squeeze this thing inside the virus, there are some estimates of the pressure inside that viral head. Imagine inflating an automobile tire. It's about 50 atmospheres. So you can sort of see why it might explode if we were to crack it open because of all that pressure, and it's the pressure of compactification that's playing a role. So let me take a very simple model of a polymer, and let's do some very simple counting exercises to try to sort of figure out what's going on. And the simple model I'd like you to think about, let's just take one of these shoelaces, is a fairly flexible thing. Turns out that single-stranded DNA is really very flexible, easy to bend. And a priori, I can go through all sorts of configurations that this DNA might exhibit inside the cytoplasm or inside a watery solution. And from an energetic point of view, since the thin linear objects don't intersect each other very often, this is an object where energy doesn't really vary very much from one configuration to the next. So if I were to stretch it out, but not really pull on it, just let it gently go to its maximum length, that energy is almost the same as this energy. So not much is happening from the point of view of energy. But let's count configurations and try to figure out what's going on. And let's take a look at the world's simplest model of a polymer. Let's imagine that the polymer is sitting on a lattice. So let's imagine we have like a checkerboard arrangement of possible places where our polymer can make a turn and might be doing something like that. Not because I believe space is really divided up into a lattice, but if the details don't matter that much, when I have a large number of independent units, maybe I can get away with a fairly simplified model. So what size lattice do we take? Well, if I take the shoelace, with almost no cost of energy, I can bend it over a length that's about the diameter of the shoelace. So let's take that to be our lattice size, because on larger scales, the polymer is very flexible. I can't turn it really, really tightly, but I can certainly turn it rather gently on the scale of this diameter. So that will be the size of this, of a little spacing on this lattice, and the details of the lattice turn out not to be important. And if you suspend your disbelief of this simple model, let's do a simple counting exercise and regard the polymer as a kind of random walk. We're going to be counting configurations of polymers that are living on this lattice. They're all going to start at the origin and move outwards in various ways. And in this simple two-dimensional example, the polymer could move one north, south, east, or west. And so from this perspective, since I start here, and I have four choices the first time, and then I could go back on myself, I could backtrack a little bit, make a hairpin. I have four choices the next time. Only have two steps in this random walk. And so there's 16 possibilities. And I've enumerated the number of ways of starting at the origin, and ending up at the various places on this little square lattice. So for example, to get out here, I could have one step to the east and one step to the north, or I could reverse the order. I could go north and then east. Those would be two distinct polymer configurations in this simple model that end up in the same place. There's also two ways of going here, here, and here. It's only one way of stretching out to its full length, going two steps to the east, so there's one here, and then I can go out and back four different ways. Now each of these outcomes, counting configurations, has its own length, its own preferred length, so this length here would be two in my units. This length here, being the diagonal square, would be the square root of two. This length going coming back to the origin is zero. And it turns out the average of just the actual, what's called a vector, we go out here, vanishes, but I can look at the square. The square is always positive, and there are 4 out of 16 possibilities of going a distance of zero. I square that. There are 2 out of 16, each one of these corners, times 4, going a distance square root of 2 along this diagonal, and then there's this final result here. And so I can get at least the average square, just by sort of almost counting on my fingers and trying to remember the Pythagorean theorem. And the result is 2. Pretty simple. Just 2. Now, I could do it for 4. I won't spend an enormous amount of time on it because I'm bored. I'm trying to do this instead of Sudoku, so you can count up these configurations. And you can see that the numbers are getting a little large. There are 24 ways of going out to here. I'll just give you an example of a polymer configuration that starts at the origin, goes one step west, then two steps north, and another step west. There turns out to be 6 ways to get here. Now, all configurations that start at the origin, each one has 4 possibilities. So it's 4 times 4 times 4 times 4. So they're now 256 possibilities. But notice that the possibilities that have the large numbers here, like 36 or 16 or 24, are all close to the origin. And that there are relatively few ways of stretching this polymer out to be perfectly straight. And I laboriously, since you probably have better things to do, worked out all these ways. So the square root of 2, square root of 8, square root of 10, and they're all weighted by the number of ways of having, say, length 0. I square it, so I'm getting, for a 4-step random walk, what actually happens in detail. And this adds up to 4. There's a pattern here. Can you guess what it might be? We'll figure it out. But the basic idea is that if you take the average square size, you take the average, you can always take a square root of this to get a sort of typical size of the polymer. I'm going to now show you that it scales like the number of steps. I've taken L equals 1 here, and so that would give 4. And it would give 2 for a 2-step random walk. And many of you have seen perhaps this kind of calculation before, but if you haven't, it's worth doing a little bit at the board. So I'm going to start here. And I'm going to be a little more general. I'm not going to be on the lattice actually anymore. I'm just going to work out the mean square end to end distance. So that will be some measure of the size, as you'll see. So let's imagine, I'll just guess the calculation here, that I just have a bunch of lengths. Each one of these lengths will be persistence length long. And I'll have a little vector here that tells me I go from this step, another vector here, and then some god-awful configuration like this. And if this is the nth step in this random walk, then the I can characterize the end-to-end distance by just a sum over all these individual steps. So this is sometimes called a drunkard's walk. You come out of a bar and hopefully no traffic is around. You might be staggering around the street on this kind of pathway. And if you really had a few too many beers or whatever, you will be wandering around aimlessly, north, south, east, west, all directions in between. And each one of these guys will have a length, so say L3, for example, I'll call that L. That will be analog to this length, and I don't even have to be on the lattice to do this simple calculation. This is a, as I said, sometimes called a random walk. And all you need to know, for the purposes of this this little argument, is that if I sum over all the possible drunken, staggering trajectories, I can calculate what's going on with this end-to-end distance. So this is just summing up all these little steps. The end-to-end distance is pictorially, it's going from where I started to where I end up. This is R squared. Notice here, I sure ended up fairly close to where I started. But I could have stretched myself out like that shoelace. If I now average over all possible configurations, this end-to-end distance, what do you think I get? Any these brilliant students in the audience, if you can perhaps could answer this question.
Zero.
Why? Because I can end up north, south, east, west, all directions in between, and so if I do that kind of aimless walk, just ask the computer about it. But I can still get a sense of the size, just like I did in those that counting argument over there, by looking at the square of this thing. And it's just a little mathematical exercise. It's easier to take two of these and square them, and then take three and square them, and eventually a pattern emerges. The pattern that emerges is that when I square this thing, I get L1 times L1, and that's going to be L squared. It's something like that. That occurs n times. And then I get a bunch of other terms that all involve, this is, I apologize, I'm going to use fancy math symbols, but don't worry about it. I'll be back hand-waving vigorously in a minute. But if I have two different lengths, they're uncorrelated. They both could be going north, south, east, or west. And a little bit of thought, I think you can convince yourself that these other terms, like where I have L1 combined with L17 or whatever, this is going to be useful. And so as a result, the only thing left over here is NL squared. That's kind of interesting because if I take the square root just to get a typical size, after all, I am taking a length square, if I take the square root of this thing here, the size is only the square root of the number of lengths, or the number of independent entities. So if I have a 10,000 step random walk, it's only going to be size 100. So it'll be 1% of the end-to-end distance. And that shrinkage, just because there are more configurations at short distances than stretched out, is really what's going on here. And the fancy word for it is entropy. In other words, if I have a one of these polymer configurations, it's going to crumple up to a size that's about the square root of its length. Not because there's some attractive well or attractive energy, it's just because there are so many more configurations. And there just aren't a lot of configurations when you stretch it out. You can sort of go around like that, but that's all. Nothing compared to the intricate ways of tangling up something that gets shrunk down to a size which is extremely tiny compared to its stretched out length. So I have a little instruction, go to Blackboard, but if I were to run that, you can move on. This is what was on the blackboard. In case I took off, or the chalk didn't work. So the take-home message is that on scales large compared to this bending length, this persistence length, DNA configurations can be approximated by random walks. And here's an actual 10,000 step random walk, I think it's 10,000, that I did on a computer. And the And you know, it looks like this sort of strange looking thing, but it's shrunken compared to what it would be if it were all stretched out. And here are seven random walks, all starting at the same place. These are all possible configurations of a piece of single-stranded or double-stranded DNA, and they form a kind of probabilistic cloud of endpoints, possible endpoints of these random walks, all shrunken by this this factor that goes like n to the 1/2. That's the basic result. These are called phantom random walks because they are somewhat fantastical, because we haven't allowed them, we haven't worried about them self-intersecting. So if I just let the shoelace aimlessly wander around, occasionally it'll try to spear through itself. And so there are somewhat fewer random walks than you might think, just because atoms can't pass through each other very easily. It's not a huge effect here, but I'll just, for completeness, record it. A more sophisticated argument that includes the self-avoidance of these linear polymer chains, which occasionally will get in each other's way, is that it leads to a kind of swelling. And so if I have n independent units, instead of n to the 1/2, it's n to the 3/2. So this is the 0.6 power. It's only a little bit bigger than 0.8. So that's a subtlety that I'll just briefly mention probably at the end. So what does this have to do with springs? Well, I'm not going to attempt to teach everybody here about the mysterious concept of entropy, but I'm going to appeal to a higher authority, and that's a gravestone. So this is Ludwig Boltzmann, who was the first person to understand entropy. And he came up with a formula for it, and he was so pleased with the formula that he put it on his grave. So if you go to Vienna, you can look and find S equals K times the logarithm of something called W. He was very proud of that. We now put a subscript B on K to honor Boltzmann. It stands for Boltzmann, but he was very modest and only just put a K on his grave. And all you need to know from this talk is that if I have a certain number of configurations of, say, a polymer going from one point to another, suppose I fix the distance, the vector distance from the origin, suppose I want to be the square root of 10 away, all the random walks that end up at the square root of 10, I count them up, that's W. W will depend on where I end up also. And there's something called a free energy that Boltzmann also knew a lot about. And it consists of the regular energy, which I've already told you is kind of unimportant for these polymers. There's not a lot of actual energy involved. But then there's this T times S. And that's the entropy coming in to give something that will behave qualitatively like an energy. It's called free energy for that reason. So if I neglect E, then this free energy is plugging in this graveyard formula, is kVT times the logarithm of the number of configurations. And we already figured out a lot about the configurations, and that's really all that we're going to need here. And in two dimensions, to make a long story short, apologize for the math, but basically that set of numbers, that set of terminal points for random walks. If I go back here a little bit, go back to, I think I may have frozen up my entire computer. See if I can get this back here. Go back. Computer is having a nervous breakdown as we speak here. The basic idea, hopefully we'll come out of this death spiral, is the following. If I go look at these random walks, then here's the number. I'll try to give you a plausibility argument. The number of random walks after n steps that end up a distance r away from the origin, it's a Gaussian. It's a Gaussian distribution. It's the famous bell curve that you often find in statistics textbooks, for example. And the crucial thing is that the scale in this exponent that determines the size is nl squared. It's just the result that we found over here. And so when R is much, much bigger than L squared, there aren't a lot of random walks out there because this exponential is very tiny. This is just in there for normalization. Z to the n is the total number of walks, so this is a probability. And then we just use Boltzmann's formula. We take S as the logarithm of this number W, and the result is that because there's an R squared up here, the result is an energy that goes like the square of the distance. And the bonus that comes out is this prefactor, which turns out to be like a spring constant, and it just is this factor I advertised earlier, kbt, over the contour length, the total number of steps, if you like, in a random walk, times L. And then, to finally complete this little story, you can add a force. So this, let's imagine I take my DNA. It's now coiled up. And there's this harmonic quadratic energy, sort of like a spring. And then I add a force with laser tweezers that sort of pulls it apart. Okay? So I add a force. And this is the standard way physicists like to use to add forces. And if you now minimize this expression and say, what is the lowest free energy for a given force? You'll find that the force is K times R, and you will have figured out this entropic spring constant. So that's the result of this linear polymer chains. Let's hope that my computer is going to behave itself. I may need to reboot here. Try this. Okay, let's take a look at the task manager and
quit Chrome.
I'm not responding. That's not a good thing, right? So I'm getting rid of that and end that task.
No, quit Chrome.
Wait for program. Check for solution. Restart the program. No, I just want you to restart. Okay. Thank you. Glad to have all these experts in the audience. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I guess I should thank Bill Gates. Thank him. Or curse at him. In any event, this is what we've shown. And the idea is that if I put a force on, this is the force back in that single molecule biophysics experiment. This is the spring constant. It's proportional to temperature. The bottom line is that the stiffness of the single-stranded DNA relative to the double-stranded DNA, and that was sort of the puzzle, arises because the single-stranded DNA, as you might have guessed, is a lot more flexible than the double-stranded DNA. It's a lot easier to bend this thing than to bend this double-stranded thing. And as a result, if I break this up into persistence lengths, there are many more of them than the same length of double-stranded. And so the persistence length of the single-stranded DNA is down here at the denominator, and so its spring constant is correspondingly bigger. And by looking at the ratio of this big slope to this slope down here that you can barely see, you can measure the ratio of these persistence lengths, and it's entirely different. So I'm going to try to illustrate this effect by taking this delicate crystal goblet and attaching it to these rubber bands. You can try this at home. hope it doesn't break. And the idea is the following. These rubber bands are made of polymer. Those are the polymers that were a naturally occurring rubber that were cut off in World War II, and the scientific community had to figure out how to make them artificially. And all you need to know about rubber bands is that these rubber bands, in fact, are themselves made up of entropic springs. And so here is my simple model of a rubber band. So it's a bunch of nodes, and then there are these polymers that are sort of connected like some sort of crazy, chaotic set of bent springs like this. And notice that the result that came out of Boltzmann's grave, so to speak, is that the spring constant for each one of these elements of the rubber bands. This could be DNA, but some other polymer in the case of rubber. This spring constant is proportional in temperature. So, if I were to take this goblet, and with the right kind of rubber band, it's not an easy experiment to get to work, I were to put a hair dryer on it, I would heat it up, and the rubber band would shrink. So virtually all other materials like metals and semiconductors, if you heat them up, the atoms jiggle around more and they expand. DNA and rubber bands shrink. And if the the gods of public lectures are with us, this rubber band engine that was ingeniously put together by the superb staff here at the University of Colorado, Michael Thompson, Mark Klicknick, and Gwen Eckles, all contributed, and it was mostly art, I think. They made this rubber band engine. What is this rubber band engine? It's a collection of rubber bands. Here they are, rubber. This is an ordinary bicycle wheel type thing. And instead of spokes, we have rubber bands. This is exquisitely balanced, or at least we attempted, or they attempted to balance it. That's why there are these paper clips and stuff like that around. So sitting still, it's sort of fairly neutral. Sort of spinning around, and it'll go back a little bit because the center of mass and center of gravity is a little bit off. But thanks to art, we are able to shine some lights on this thing and heat up the rubber bands, only on one side. So what's going to happen? Well, let's guess. It's very rigid here in the middle, but the rubber bands on the left, being heated, will have a stiffer spring constant. In fact, although I didn't have time to show you this, I think Alex Levine showed this in the actual one of his technical lectures today. This persistence length, there's sometimes called persistence length, this length L is also temperature dependent, and it's KBT. It's some constant of matter that's weakly temperature dependent divided by temperature. So in fact, the spring constant goes by temperature squared. So this is temperature relative to absolute zero, for those of you who know about such things. But the bottom line is this is going to get hotter. The rubber bands on this side, if all goes well, will pull in more tightly, thus bending this relatively weak hoop inwards, shifting the center of mass to the right. So which way should the wheel turn?
Clockwise.
Like this. Clockwise. I better not go the other way. If it goes the other way, I'll repeat the experiment with some panels. All right, so let's see if anything happens. Okay, well, that's the wrong switch. Well, not much. It doesn't look good. But of course, it takes a while for it. If I do it too long, the rubber bands will melt. Not an excuse. So I think consistent with our expectation, it is turning clockwise, and I think we owe a round of applause for the lab staff. And if I turn it off, it stops, or at least changes. So I think I have just enough time, since I started 5 minutes late or something like that. So most 10 minutes, probably less than that, probably, to tell you about another problem. So that's a rubber band heat engine. This is a backup. And so now, I want to just take the last few minutes to tell you about something which I find kind of remarkable, which is the generalization of polymer science, linear polymers, which has been around for 7 years or so, to another fascinating set of materials, which are basically like, not like shoelaces, but like pieces of paper. Here's a piece of paper. And you know, what happens? to this piece of paper when I put it in solution. I'll show you some examples where you can do that. And what are its mechanical properties? It's a, instead of a one-dimensional object embedded in three dimensions, it's a two-dimensional object. And here's one of the things that can happen. It can sort of crumble a little bit. You might call it crinkling. So if it were to do the same thing as a linear polymer, it'd do this. So you could say, entropy. Entropy is going to cause this to crumple up, but there's so many more configurations when it's tightly crumpled up like this. But you can see that self-avoidance is going to be pretty important. There's going to be a lot of pieces of paper that bump up against each other. So it's not so obvious exactly what happens and how we would you characterize it. But it has lots of applications. So. Here are some macroscopic things, tubes, pipes, aluminum foil, and that sort of thing. And then when you get down to the microscopic level, things are very fragile, thin, soft. This is a soft matter exercise. And you can make these molecularly thin things, like graphene. I'll talk about that at the very end. Here's something called the spectrum skeleton of red blood cells, which looks a lot like a two-dimensional rubber. And that's been studied. Bacterial cell walls, the cell walls of viruses, are also shells, thin, planar, approximately planar objects, so they can be curved, and this bottom row can be very strongly influenced by entropy and thermal fluctuations. So I want to close by just telling you a few things about it. So, I'm going to characterize these objects by fractional, so-called fractal dimensions. And you bear with me, I'm going to define fractal dimension in the following way. So here's this pencil, okay? If I take this pencil and sort of looks one-dimensional, and depends on your perspective. If the pencil is extremely far away from you, it sort of looks like a point. But at intermediate distances, it looks like it's one-dimensional. If you're a little bacterium and you're embedded in the plastic of the pencil, you might look like this and say, I'm three-dimensional. So how do you answer that question? And maybe it's obvious, but you could say, how would you convince a stubborn mathematician that you have correctly identified the dimension of a pencil? So one way to do it, kind of mathematical, is to take a pencil or a rod or a ruler or whatever, and encase it in a sphere of radius r, and then we can sort of more rigorously define the dimension by asking what mass of pencil is inside the sphere as I increase the radius r. And in fact, I can do a little calculation. If there's a diameter d here, it works out that the mass scales it linearly with the radius, because there's a linear amount of mass in here. And so it goes like r to the first power. So this would be a fancy way of saying that this is one dimension. You already knew that. I can do the same exercise for the piece of paper, of course, crumpled or otherwise, but let's not crumple it for now. I have a flat piece of paper. I can take a sphere and center it on the piece of paper, and I can ask, how much mass is inside the piece of paper? How much paper is inside the sphere? And if you work that out, there's some formula that involves the thickness of the paper and so forth. But it basically goes like r squared. It's basically pi r squared embodied in paper. And the fact that there's a 2 is a fancy way, if you like, of convincing a careful, cautious mathematician that this piece of paper is two-dimensional. Moreover, this definition works well because if the radius of the sphere is smaller than the thickness of the paper, then the mass is going to increase like 4/3 pi r cubed. And so if you're a little bacterium inside the paper, you would say, aha, it's three-dimensional. And if the sphere is much bigger than the size of the paper, the mass will no longer increase at all, and you would say it's zero-dimensional. So it seems to connect with things we understand intuitively. Now, let's apply this to a polymer. And let's apply it to a self-avoiding polymer so that instead of this exponent 1 half that I would get by taking the square root of here, it goes like n to the 3 halves. So that's I just quoted that. But if we accept this result that the size of a polymer with n monomers is n to the 3 halves, I can solve this equation for n. N is the mass. So the bottom line is that the mass goes like the size, which is r, to the 5/3 power. And so these crumpled disorderly polymers and compromise between entropy and self-avoidance have a fractional dimension. They're not one-dimensional, they're not two, they're 5/3. And you can play the same games with crumpled sheet polymers as some of my collaborators did in ancient times. We actually took pieces of paper of varying size. We crumpled them. We also wanted to see whether paper was special, so we redid the experiment with aluminum foil. Nicely holds its shape. And as a function of the linear dimensions of the thing that we crumpled, we plotted the diameter, and that enabled us to read off the dimension of this incredibly intricate structure that is formed by a humble crumpled piece of paper, and we found about 2.5. Fractional, not two-dimensional, not three-dimensional. Three-dimensional is what I would get if I would take this thing and intelligently fold it over and over again to make a solid cube. Then the effective dimension would turn out to be three-dimensional. And I'll tell you later how you get avoid the problem of multiple folds, because you really only can do it about 7 times. But if you could continue to do that, you would get something that's three-dimensional. It's not in 2 nor 3, it's 2.5 dimensional. So this is a more sophisticated, later version of this experiment. It's crumpling on a computer. The dimension is 2.3. So we can have fractional dimensions. This is perhaps what entropy might favor, but this was just done by crushing. And I'll conclude with just a kind of advertisement for the students who might come to my seminar on Thursday, a bit more technical. And I'll talk about some very recent work on graphene. Graphene is the thinnest known material. It's made of carbon atoms. It supposedly has some nice applications, but it's one atom thick. Can't get any thinner than graphene. So with graphene, we sort of reach the Moore's law limit of thinness. And this incredible ratio here is the size of a graphene sheet would be 100 of those microns, maybe 1/10,000th of a micron thick. That's the size of an atom. They're very flexible. And now we can ask, what happens if we liberate graphene from its pristine substrate and allow it, if it wishes, to crumple. So this is a needle that is being pressed under a single atomically thin sheet of graphene. See the wrinkles? And now the needle will retract. The experiments of Paul McKeown's group at Cornell. And you can see it almost completely heals. The carbon-carbon bonds are very strong. This is the analog of a single molecule biophysics experiment done on a graphene ribbon. And that's actually a magnetic pad at the end. And like most physicists, this group enjoys torturing innocent pieces of graphene, twisting them up, pulling them, and so forth. And the question is, what are the properties of such a ribbon? So I'll conclude, that's Paul McKeown. By just saying, okay, what did they do? Well, they did a cantilever experiment. It's the simplest experiment you can imagine doing. It was, as someone said today, studied long ago by Galileo. This is his treatise on two new disciplines. One was physics, one was mechanics. And notice this pathetic piece of paper can't even hold up its own weight. But this wooden beam holds up that big stone with no problem. But now, let's imagine that when I crumple something, it doesn't actually crumple up into a ball, but it retains some sort of thermal wrinkles. And let's take these wrinkles in the piece of paper as a proxy for thermal wrinkles. This thing has no trouble. So compare this piece of paper with this thing here. And there's something remarkable about this. And that was done not for a piece of paper, but for atomically thin graphene by this group. And the bottom line is, because of these thermal wrinkles, it appears that this isolated sheet of graphene used for this cantilever experiment is 6,000 times stronger than it would be without the thermal fluctuations. So it's an enormous enhancement, and they're hoping to make little graphene heat engines, and, you know, for fun. I don't know how practical it is. So with that illustration, I will stop, and thank you for your attention.
We'll take a little bit of time for some questions.
So these long-chain polymers of DNA, do they get tied up into complicated knots? And if not, how do they avoid that?
That's a great question. The question was, how does the DNA or the other chains that avoid forming knots, you know, like this, for example? And so there's a couple answers. One biological answer is that most all bacteria actually have DNA which is loose. And so that makes it a little harder to make a knot. But nevertheless, they do get knotted under the ordinary processes of cell division. Sometimes they end up with complicated structures. And then what happens is there's an amazing enzyme that comes to the rescue, and it can allow DNA to pass through itself and de-knot. That's one comment. Proteins and human DNA, I think, animal DNA, has free ends. So knotting, in some sense, is easier, but it's not irreversible. You can always unknot. And people have studied the folded up amino acid chains that make proteins, and sort of taken the two ends and pulled and counted the number of proteins that get knots. And, you know, maybe 5% of them have a knot. But because they do have the two free ends, they have a way of eventually resolving things. And I would say there, the two free ends move around due to sort of Brownian motion and thermal fluctuations. And there are all sorts of interesting questions, not completely well understood, about knot entropy. Do knotted configurations have more or less entropy, a little bit less? So in the case of biology, I think the short answer is that often a magic enzyme will come to the rescue. Not a very satisfactory answer at some level, but that's what evolution can do. Yes, please.
Going back to your question at the beginning of how DNA is packed into a tiny volume in the head of a virus.
Yeah.
You appeal to entropy.
Yep.
If the DNA is comfortable and wants to be in a tiny state,
yep.
How did it explode then?
Okay. So, the great question. If I can rephrase it, it's what's going on in these viral head groups? Maybe it's happy. Why is it exploding? So I didn't say this, but if you work out for a virus with the 50,000 base pairs, the optimal size, the radius of gyration according, say, to that formula with a certain persistence length, you'll discover it's still too big. It's still too big. And so a lot of these viruses may well end up having DNA that's somehow tightly packed like a mountaineer's rope, and they get very, very pressurized, and they actually have to burn the kind of chemical energy currency, ATP. They have to burn a lot of ATPs, use up a lot of energy to get this tight, this little tight compartment. And it's to the advantage of a virus to have a long sequence in a tiny volume, because it has to be small enough to get into, to infect the bacteria, which is already pretty small. And then you want to get as much information in there so you have a sophisticated computer program that helps you take over. So presumably, just hand waving, that burning of the ATP is to the virus's advantage. But thank you for putting that out. It shrinks, but not enough to neatly fit into a viral head, typically. Yes, please.
So the experiment you mentioned shows that the crumbling can greatly, dramatically change the mechanics, you know, properties of the polymers, for example.
Yes.
My question is for like a biological object, like a protein.
Yes.
If you crumble the protein, how does that affect the biological functionalities?
So again, to paraphrase, if I have a protein, it's clearly... seems to be very compact. It might sort of look like this object here. I guess the way to say it is that it's crumpled, but here energy really matters. So those amino acids, unlike the DNA or the RNA that I talked about at the very beginning, those amino acids will often have pairwise attractive interactions that guide the folding of the amino acid polymer into a specific shape that's tailored to the function. So it folds up, it probably has fractal dimension 3. It's not any one of these exotic things, like a fractal dimension 2.5. It's more compact than this crumpled piece of paper. And energy plays an important role, and a still active research area is the sort of the second half of the genetic code. Given an amino acid sequence, what compact shape will it fold into? And so people still work very hard on that. It's a very important part of biology. But let me give a plug for the humble cobble cheese paper or tinfoil. You can go home and take a piece of tinfoil like this, take a hacksaw, cut it open, and look at the exquisitely textured nooks and crannies and cave-like appendages. It's an amazing object, as are proteins.
Maybe it's getting late, so if you have other questions, you can come by and ask David in private. Otherwise, please join me. Thank you.